right, so let's go to that exclusive information from Fox Undercover about that welding company owner implicated in that deadly Back Bay fire. The owner was allegedly responsible for welding work being done without a permit at the building next door to the fire. Well, now Fox Undercover is learning that this welder has a history with that building, and that's just the start of what our investigative reporter Mike Baudette has for us. Hello, everybody. I'm Maria Stefanos.
And I'm Mark Ockerblum. So, Mike, fill us in.
All right, Aka Maria, the owner of that welding company is Giuseppe Falcone. He was the head of D&J Welding, which is out of Malden. That company has since disbanded in 2010, according to records from the Secretary of State's office. But the building that burned, the owner of the building that burned, is accusing Falcone and D&J of negligence. Investigators have already said that it was welders working on an iron railing behind 296 Beacon Street that set off the fire next door at 298 Beacon Street. Well, now we've learned that Falcone has worked on 296 Beacon Street before. City inspection records show that the fire escape behind 296 Beacon Street was inspected in 2004 by none other than Giuseppe Falcone. Back then, Falcone signed an affidavit saying the fire escape there conformed to the state building code that regulates fire escapes. But that's just half the story. The state building code requires fire escapes to be certified as safe every 5 years. But 2004, 10 years ago, is the latest inspection on file with Boston Inspectional Services. The next one should have been done in 2009, and then again this year, but nothing is on file since 2004.
Date now. How does this all tie in?
Well, first, it shows that this is not Giuseppe Falcone's first time working at 296 Beacon Street. Though in his response to the lawsuit that we reported on yesterday, we learned that he denies personally doing the welding work there this year. Secondly, it's raising some questions about the work being done there this year. Was it to fix the fire escape? When you look at the ironwork behind the building, it all seems to be part of the building's fire escape. Now, that video right there that you're looking at is D&J Welding in Malden. But when we go to the back of the building, of 296, and you look at that, you can actually see that it looks like just fire escapes, and that's what we're looking at now. Now, the welders that were there doing that work in March, fixing the fire escape, were they doing that? Well, if they were, it raises the question. Would the outcome have been different had the fire escape been inspected and perhaps repaired in 2009? Let's find out more about fire escape inspections. Joining us now, Amy Cronin, an expert on building and fire code. She's president of Strategic Code Solutions, formerly with the National Fire Protection Association. We appreciate you being here. Let's just talk about fire escape inspections. What's involved and why do they happen every 5 years?
Well, it's required by the Massachusetts Building Code as well as the International Fire Code in Boston, and they are required to be every 5 years, and it's really important that they be done regularly because the fire escape system is part of the required means of egress. And what I mean by that is when the building was built, they did a calculation based on the number of people and how they would get out of the building should there be an emergency. So the fire escapes are absolutely crucial, and because they're outside, they're subject to the outside conditions, and you really need to make sure that they're safe without damage.
Now, from investigators, we know that the welders that were working at 296 were working on an iron railing. We've gone out there, we've looked. I mean, it looks like all of the iron railings out there are connected to that fire escape, at least from what we can see. So it just does raise the question, why were they doing the work now? And could something have been prevented if they had done work earlier, had done these inspections earlier?
Well, it's interesting because the affidavit from 2004 said that it was safe. We have to question if it were, if it had been done in 2009, perhaps there may have been some damage there. Like if you think about rust, if you catch it early enough before there's massive damage and there needs to be reconstruction, maybe the welding would have never been done. Now we're making the leap that there might have been damage to the fire escape system. So, but you have to inspect it to make sure that it's maintained properly.
Okay, these inspections are supposed to happen every 5 years. It wasn't like we just went through one cycle. It's now 10 years later. So at least according to the city records that we got from Inspectional Services, they've missed two cycles. How does that happen? Is no one checking?
That's a great question. And I think a lot of times there are so many regulations, and if somebody, it takes a while to be caught in a violation. So if, you know, the main thing I would say is if you're a building owner or you're a tenant of a building, make sure that these inspections are done and that, you know, all of the fire regulations and building regulations are followed as part of your safety.
And again, we can't prove based on the records that in fact the work that was being done this year that led to that deadly fire that killed the two Boston firefighters was in fact connected to the fire escape. But we can, based on the records, show that Giuseppe Falcone did a fire escape inspection back then. Is that typical that you would have someone in the welding profession do that type of inspection?
From what I understand, the people that sometimes do the repairs or the installation, they also do the inspections. And per the requirements, it says, per the Massachusetts Building Code, it can be anybody who is qualified and acceptable to the building official. Now, on the affidavit, it's a little more specific for the city of Boston in that it has to be a registered Massachusetts professional engineer or a it has to be a licensed fire escape installer. And from what I understand on the affidavit, there was a license number there, so that insinuates that perhaps he was licensed.
And you've actually got a copy of one of these affidavits?
I do.
Maybe you can just hold that up so people can see it. So this is actually something, this is the record that we saw that in fact Giuseppe Falcone had signed back in 2004, and you're signing that under the pains of perjury.
That's right. And in the building code and fire codes, it really just gives really performance-based requirements. It needs to be structurally adequate and safe. So it's really relying on the education and the expertise and the experience of the inspector. So it's super important that you get somebody who's really qualified.
Clearly a lot of unanswered questions still, but this is raising, I think, even more questions about the fire escape. Was that the work that was being done? And also when we see Giuseppe Falcone, the owner of D&J Welding, coming out in a court filing and denying any involvement in that, yet now we're able to tie him back to that exact building 10 years ago. There are a lot of questions we don't have the answers to.
That is correct. And another point that I thought was somewhat interesting is he knows his way around the building codes and fire codes, so you have to question, was he, you know, he should have known about the welding permit and the other welding requirements as well.
Exactly. Amy Cronin, president of Strategic Code Solutions, we appreciate this story. We know it's far from over. We appreciate that insight tonight. So